I'm very excited about Proverbs chapter 10. There's a lot of good stuff in this one. And you know, the thing about Proverbs is it's so vast. If I were to preach everything in this chapter, which I don't know everything, it would, we'd just go on forever and ever and ever. But if you turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 16, just to start out, it says, the proverb of Solomon, a wise son maketh a glad father, but a foolish son is the heaviness of his mother. I want to spend some time on that thought. It's saying a wise son maketh a glad father, but a foolish son is the heaviness of his mother. There in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, in verse 16, the Bible says, that ye submit yourselves unto such, and everyone that helpeth with us and laboreth. I am glad of the coming of Stephanus and Fortunatus and Achaeus, for that which is lacking on your part they have supplied. For they have refreshed my spirit and yours. Therefore acknowledge ye them that are such. So I want to kind of jump into the spiritual aspect of being a glad father. Paul had many people that he was winning to Christ, teaching them the gospel, training them up. And he sees he's glad for the coming of Stephanus, Fortunatus, Achaicus. I mean, these are three guys that are coming along in the Spirit, and he's like a spiritual father in them. Paul talks about many times like Timothy being his son in the Lord. And we see that he's glad because these guys are coming up and they're doing well. And that's one of the great things about being a father. When you see your son doing well, when you see your son being a wise son, it brings such gladness, such joy into your life. And it says that a foolish son is the heaviness of his mother. If y'all would turn to Numbers chapter 11. Numbers chapter 11. I want to kind of get these moments here, and then we're going to look at a story which I think really typifies what this is saying. But isn't it just so true that our spiritual lives are representative of what this book is saying? When we look at our lives with the Lord Jesus Christ, when we get saved, we become what? A son, right? The Bible says, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. When you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you become a son. And just as much as a son is to a father on an earthly sense, we are to the Lord Jesus Christ. And we should think, hey, is God pleased with me? Well, are you doing what he said? Are you a wise son? You know that lie that God's not mad at you? That's not true, even if you're saved. Look, if you're saved, you better be living for God or he's not going to be pleased with you. He's talking about sons. You know, you love all your sons, but you're not always pleased with every son. You know, and sometimes I was thinking about this. I don't think the Bible is wrong to say that there's favorites. I mean, to look at you like, I have two sons, I love them both, but this one I like a little bit more. You know, he's a little bit more wise. You know, he's a hard worker. He brings me so much joy in my life. And isn't that what you want your father to say about you? Are you the good son or are you the bad son? Is your parents look at you and say, hey, this is the guy that, you know, you kind of like him just a little bit more. You know, I mean, he's always coming over. He's always calling me. He's always doing the things that I told him to do. The same thing is with the Lord Jesus Christ. When he looks at your life, how you live it determines how pleased he is with you.
Right.
If we look in Numbers 11, verse 13, it says, whence should I have flesh to give unto all this people? For they weep unto me, saying, give us flesh that we may eat. I am not able to bear all this people alone, because it is too heavy for me. You know, when I'm thinking about Moses, the Bible says that he was the meekest man on the earth.
Right.
And I always wondered what that meant. But you know what it meant? It meant that he wanted those people to succeed no matter what.
Right.
Because when he was, there were so many times where God was like looking at him, at the people, he's like, I'm just going to destroy him. And Moses was like, no, don't destroy him. They're your people. You gave him this promise. He's like laying down his life. He's a mediator in between God and the children of Israel from being destroyed. Why? Because he's meek. Because he's looking at these people like, I just want you to succeed. And just like a mother, she always wants her son to succeed. She never wants to give up on her son. She never wants anything bad for her son. And so when that son's foolish, when that son's forsaking the ways of his mother, it's just a burden on her. It's just so heavy because she can't get rid of it. You know, I think men can compartmentalize that a little bit. They're like, I just don't really like that son because he's just not doing anything I said. And he just moves on. But unto a mother, there's just so much more attachment there. They have so much desire for that son to succeed, and it's so much of a burden onto them. Because they gave life unto it. They gave suck unto it probably. They raised it. They spent so much time with it. And for it to just be foolish and forsake what they said, it's a heaviness unto the mother. That's why it's so important for children to pay attention to their parents, to be good unto their parents, to follow what their parents said. Because there's always going to have authority in your life. I don't care who you are on this planet, you're subject unto somebody. You say, who am I subject unto? I'm an anarchist. I don't believe in government. Let's say we threw government out. Well, you're either subject unto Christ or you're a servant unto sin. But you're not free. You're going to be subject unto something. There's always going to be authority in your life. And if you're a child and you can't subject yourself unto your parents, you're going to struggle with authority your entire life. You're never going to be that wise son. You're never going to be that wise son in the faith. That's why it's so important for children to hearken unto their parents, to hearken unto the voice of their mom and dad, and to be a wise son, which maketh a glad father. Turn, if y'all would, to Genesis chapter 37. I was thinking about the story of Joseph and how it really just shows how a father can have more love for one son than another. Or be more pleased with one son than another. And if you look in Genesis chapter 37, verse 2, the Bible says, these are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. I want to subject him to this thought that Joseph's brothers were foolish men. They were not hard workers. They were lazy. They didn't do what their father said. And Joseph came unto him and said, look, these kids, they're not doing what they're supposed to be doing. He's bringing their evil report unto their father. Go down to verse 15. It says, and a certain man found him, and behold, he was wandering in the field. And the man asked him, saying, what seekest thou? So Joseph, he's told by his father to go find his brethren. And he tells them that they're in this one place. So Joseph goes and he looks for them. They're not there. So he has to go into some other place. You know, it's probably because these kids, you know, they're just not doing what their father said. They're not hearkening unto their father. They're just doing their own thing. They're foolish children. Flip over to Genesis 42 and verse 1. And now we know that Joseph's brothers sell Joseph into slavery. And then he goes into Egypt. And we learn a little bit about the brothers and some of their wickedness. And then we find out about Joseph. But we get back into verse, let's back up to Genesis chapter 41. Let's back up a few verses there. Give me a second to turn there. It's talking about what's happening in the land, pretty much the whole earth there, in Genesis chapter 41. It says in verse 56, and the famine was over all the face of the earth, and Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold them to the Egyptians, and the famine waxed sore in the land of Egypt. And all the countries came into Egypt to Joseph for to buy corn, because that the famine was so sore in all the lands. So there was a famine in all of the land. And it says in verse 1, now when Jacob saw that there was corn in Egypt, Jacob said unto his sons, why do you look one upon another? So there's a famine in the land, and his sons are just looking at each other like, what do we do? You know? And there's two people in this world. There's people that have solutions, and there's people that just sit around just wondering what's going to happen. His brothers were not people with solutions. But Joseph was a man with solutions. He was a man, he came to Pharaoh and said, this is what you have to do. You need to collect one-fifth of all the food, and you need to store it up for 7 years, and you give all these instructions unto Pharaoh because he was a wise son. But the foolish sons, they're just standing around like, well, there's nothing to eat. There's nothing to do. Let's go back to Proverbs chapter 10. Says in verse 2, treasures of wickedness profit nothing, but righteousness delivereth from death. The Lord will not suffer the soul of the righteous to famish, but he casteth away the substance of the wicked. He becometh poor that dealeth with a slack hand, but the hand of the diligent maketh rich. He that gathereth in summer is a wise son, but he that sleepeth in harvest is a son that causeth shame. Blessings are upon the head of the just, but violence covereth the mouth of the wicked. The memory of the just is blessed, but the name of the wicked shall rot. So right here in this whole section, I just can't help but think of Joseph. I mean, it says here in verse 2, the treasures of wickedness profit nothing, but the righteous will be delivered from death. We know that Reuben, when he saw his brothers plotting against him, he delivered him. Now I believe if Joseph was not a righteous man, if he wasn't living after God, God probably wouldn't have influenced Reuben to save his life. But we know even the righteous, heading for the death of destruction of his brethren, was saved. He was saved by Reuben and he was preserved. And God will preserve the righteous, even in the midst of some kind of dark, you know, destruction that they're headed towards.
Amen.
It says that treasures of wickedness profit nothing. Turn, if you would, to Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12. It said that Reuben heard it, he delivered them out of their hands and said, let us not kill him. And Reuben said unto him, shed no blood, but cast into this pit that is in the wilderness, and lay no hand upon him, that he might rid him out of his hands and deliver him to his father again. So God gave Joseph a way of escape. He preserved him. And in Psalms 31, verse 23, the Bible says, O love the Lord, all ye saints, for the Lord preserveth the faithful, and plentiful rewardeth the proud doer. God says that he will preserve the faithful. He doesn't say he'll preserve every son. He says he'll preserve the faithful. So you know you want to be preserved? We're heading in some dark times. We're heading in some perilous times. Do you want to be preserved? Well, you better be one of the faithful. As you turn to Luke chapter 12, in verse 16, the Bible says, And he spake a parable unto them, saying, The ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, What shall I do, because I have no room where to bestow my fruits? And he said, This will I do. I will pull down my barns and build greater, and there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. I will say to my soul, Soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine these, eat, drink, and be merry. And God said unto him, Thou fool! This night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. So we see this rich man, he had laid up all these riches, all these treasures unto himself. And he's like, man, I have so many goods, I have so many riches, I'm going to build even bigger barns so I can have even more riches. You know, he's going to get another bank. He's going to have bank accounts everywhere. He's going to have it flooding with money. He's like, man, this is so great. And God's like, thou fool. You don't even understand that tomorrow you're going to die. And then what are you going to have? The treasures of wickedness are profit nothing. And look, my friend, the Bible says that we should be rich toward God. You can be rich in this life, but not of earthly things. Be rich of heavenly things, of eternal things that will carry forward. That's what that kind of riches I want. I want to take a whole bunch of souls with me to heaven and have riches in heaven. I don't want to take a whole bunch of money with me because I can't. Yeah. And even if I leave it here, who's it for? Just for the wicked to have more money. Because the wicked always get more money. Right. Turn, if you would, to Psalms chapter 37. So we see that the Bible saying, treasures of wickedness profit nothing, but righteousness delivereth from death. What's more important, to have the treasures of this world, or to have the righteousness? It's more important to have the righteousness. That's why the Lord will not suffer the soul of the righteous to famish. That's a promise. He says, look, if you're faithful, if you're living under God, He's going to make sure you get taken care of. He's not going to let you famish. Even when it looked really grim for Joseph, he was taken care of. He was provided for. In Psalm 37 it says, Fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass, and wither as the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good. So shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. I think that's so crucial. He's saying, look, you don't have to fret evildoers. If you trust in the Lord, that's salvation. But then more importantly, he says, and do good. Look, you want to be preserved by God? Do good. He's not just going to preserve somebody because they're saved. You also have to do good. You also have to be that wise son. You can't just be this foolish son who's saved and doing nothing. Like in Romans 4:5, when Paul said, But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. But I don't want to be that guy. I don't want to be the guy that stands in heaven and is like, Hey, I trusted in you to be my Savior. But that was it. You know, I live for money. I live for riches. I live for this world. That guy's going to suffer loss on the day of judgment, according to the Bible.
Right.
And he says, trust the Lord and do good, so shalt thou dwell in the land. You want to have a good life? You want to have goods? You want to be preserved? Do good. Let's go to verse 3 in Proverbs chapter 10. Let's go back. It says that the Lord will not suffer the soul of the righteous to famish, but he casteth away the substance of the wicked. We see that the brothers of Joseph were there. And what happened when he left? A famine came in the land. They were without. We see that those that want to live in wickedness, that want to live in sin, God's going to bring punishment unto those people. They might go into a famine. It could be all kinds of famine. Maybe you lose your job. Maybe you lose a family member. Maybe you lose your health. Lose whatever. But it's so important that you're faithful unto God and you do good. It says in verse 4, He becometh poor that dealeth with a slack hand, but the hand of the diligent maketh rich. You're not going to get rich just by sitting around doing nothing. You're going to get rich by working hard. Yeah. How are you going to get rich toward God? By working hard. By going out and preaching the gospel one at a time and getting someone saved. How are you going to get rich in this world? I mean, just in a fleshly sense. Going out and working hard. There's a direct parallel to working hard and gaining riches. Whether that be, you know, earthly riches or heavenly riches. It's all the same. So if you want to have goods, if you want to have things, you got to work hard. And God says that He's going to make sure this gets enforced. He becometh poor that dealeth with a slack hand. Says, he that gathereth in summer is a wise son, but he that sleepeth in harvest is a son that causes shame. Look, you got to be working all the year. In the summer when it's hot, in the winter when it's cold, go out and preach the gospel and get people saved. Go out and work a good, hard job so you can have money to provide for your family. Says in verse 6, blessings are upon the head of the just, but violence covereth the mouth of the wicked. God wants to put a blessing on your head, but it says He does it on the just. He doesn't say it just on anybody, but on the just. It says there, but violence covereth the mouth of the wicked. Look, you can have blessing in your life, or you can have violence because of the wicked things that are coming out of your mouth. It says, the memory of the just is blessed, but the name of the wicked shall rot. How many wicked, evil people do we know? And just their name just makes people cringe, you know? I mean, you say Adolf Hitler, and people are like, ugh, you know? Or just Judas. I mean, just even the name. Doesn't it just kind of rot? Doesn't it just kind of feel heavy? I mean, when you just hear wicked people's names, Joseph Stalin. I mean, people aren't just like, whoa, that sounds like a good name. I mean, how many people name their kid Judas? I mean, it's so rare. You got like wicked, evil reprobates that want to change their name to that. But I mean, nobody wants to name their son Judas. I mean, even though that was the name of the Lord's brother. I mean, he was probably a pretty good guy. He wasn't mentioned that much in the Bible. But I mean, look, the name of the wicked shall rot. Let's go on to the next section. It says in verse 8, the wise in heart will receive commandments, but a prating fool shall fall. He that walketh uprightly walketh surely, but he that perverteth his way shall be known. He that winketh with the eye causeth sorrow, but a prating fool shall fall. The mouth of a righteous man is a well of life, but violence covereth the mouth of the wicked. Hatred stirreth up strifes, but love covereth all sins. In the lips of him that hath understanding, wisdom is found, but a rod is for the back of him that is void of understanding. Wise men lay up knowledge, but the mouth of foolish is near destruction. The rich man's wealth is a strong city, but the destruction of the poor is their poverty. The labor of the righteous tendeth to life, the fruit of the wicked to sin. He is in the way of life that keepeth instruction, but he that refuseth reproof erreth. He that hideth hatred with lying lips, and he that uttereth a slander is a fool. In the multitude of words there wanteth not sin, but he that refraineth his lips is wise. So we have a lot of things here. In verse chapter 8 it says that a prating fool shall fall. Now the interesting thing about this chapter and pretty much the whole book of Proverbs is it repeats itself over and over. And we even see this phrase mentioned both times in the Bible. So you say, what is a prating fool shall fall? What is a prating fool? When you look at the word prate in the dictionary, it says to talk foolishly or tediously about something. So it's just vain talking. It's, you know, I think the best word in the Bible is probably froward. Froward's a good word to parallel with the word prating. So God would turn to Proverbs chapter 6. Just flip back a couple chapters. Proverbs chapter 6. The Bible says in verse 10, he that winketh with the eye causeth sorrow, but a prating fool shall fall. So we see the same thing at the end of both of those verses. In Proverbs chapter 6, verse 12, the Bible says, a naughty person, a wicked man, walketh with a froward mouth. He winketh with his eyes, he speaketh with his feet, he teacheth with his fingers. Frowardness is in his heart. He deviseth mischief continually, he soweth discord. So we see a lot of the same things. He's talking about winking with the eye, he's talking about the froward mouth, he's saying he's walking with a froward mouth. Frowardness is in his heart. From the abundance of the heart to what? The mouth speaking. That's how you can tell who the wicked man is. The Bible says in verse 9 at the very end, he says, but he that perverteth his ways shall be known. How do you know who's a wicked person? How can you tell how any person is, whether they're good or bad? What's your determining factor? How they look? How they dress? Where they go? What their job is? No, it's by what they say out of their mouth. What you say out of your mouth determines what you're like. From the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh, my friend. How do I determine that someone's saved at the door? By what comes out of their mouth. By the testimony of their word. By what they say. Hey, I believe on the Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior. And I believe there's nothing I can do to lose my salvation. That's what I'm trusting in someone to be saved. Not what church they go to. Not what their house looks like. Not what kind of clothes they're wearing. Not how nice they're dressed. Not if it looks like they bathed or not. No, by the testimony of their mouth, my friend. In just the same way, the wicked, evil people of this world, I tell by what comes out of their mouth. They might look real nice. They might have a sharp suit on. They might have lots of money. They might come up to you and seem real nice, but then just wickedness spews out of their mouth. And he that perverteth the way, he shall be known. How do you know? By what comes out of their mouth. When you just hear all that wicked filth come out of their mouth, you can just tell, man, this person's a really wicked person. Yeah. This person loves all kinds of filth and wickedness. Don't ever think, oh, you know, he talks really bad, but he's probably a good person in his heart. No, from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. And the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 6, verse 12, frowardness is in his heart. Where does it come from? From your heart, my friend. Turn to 3 John chapter 1. It says in Proverbs chapter 18, verse 2, a fool hath no delight in understanding, but that his heart may discover itself. You know, a fool just constantly wants to blab and talk all kinds of stuff. He just wants to hear himself speak. He thinks he's so smart. He thinks he's so wise. He just wants to just say whatever he wants. He's a prating fool. He's got so much frowardness coming out of his mouth. And he doesn't even really even understand what he's saying. That's why he just has to talk so much just to hear himself speak. He just wants to discover what he's really like. He's like, man, you know, I was just talking and I just had this thought. I never even thought about it. I'm so great. I'm so wonderful. I mean, he just talks about all kinds of filth. He doesn't even know what he's saying. He has no pleasure in understanding. He has no delight in true understanding. If you were to talk to him about something that was true, if you were to try and correct something that came out of his mouth, he wouldn't want to hear that. He just wants to discover himself. He just wants to feel good about himself. That's what it talks about a fool. It says in 3 John chapter 1, verse 9, I wrote unto the church, but Diotrephes, who loveth to have the preeminence among them, receiveth us not. Wherefore, if I come, I will remember his deeds which he doeth, prating against us with malicious words, and not content therewith. Neither doth he himself receive the brethren, and forbidding them that would, and casteth them out of the church. Beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. He that doeth good is of God, but he that doeth evil hath not seen God. What is he saying here? He's saying, look, even this church, there is this guy in here, and he didn't even want them to come in. And he was prating against them with malicious words. How could he tell that this guy was so wicked? Because he was prating against them with malicious words, my friend. How can you tell who's wicked? By what's coming out of their mouth. That's how you can tell. And he says, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. Let's go back to Proverbs chapter 10. It says in verse 12, hatred stirreth up strife. Now I was thinking about the book of Proverbs is really interesting. Because a lot of times, it will just give you something that's true. And it's not necessarily something that you have to observe, per se. It's just a true statement. And the truth is that hatred always stirreth up strifes. Always. You want to know where you get a strife? From hatred. But does that mean that it's wrong to hate? Just because that's true? No. I mean, Jesus Christ said he came to bring division. Jesus Christ said he came to bring a sword. The Bible says to reject a heretic. The Bible says there's a time to love and a time to hate. The Bible says, do not I hate them, O Lord, that hate thee. Look, hating someone is not necessarily wrong, but you better be sure that hatred always stirs up strifes. If y'all would turn to, I don't know if I have this in my notes. The Bible's talking about stirring up strifes. It says that we should not cause a strife with a man without a cause. It says that in Proverbs. It's saying, look, you can cause a strife when there's a reason to. When someone's coming in and rejecting the gospel and you're out soul winning, correct them. You know, it's also right to say what you hate. To say that you hate things. Because we all hate things, but that might cause some strife. And is that necessarily wrong? I mean, Jesus Christ said that he hated iniquity when he was talking to the Pharisees. Jesus Christ will admit that he hates things in Revelation. He says, I hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans. We should hate certain things in this life, and that will cause strife. When you say that I hate something, someone's going to get mad at you. But you know, it's not wrong to necessarily hate something just because the Bible says there's a negative consequence. Just kind of like last week when we were talking about how when you would rebuke a scorner, sometimes you would get a blot unto yourself. When you would rebuke a wicked man, he might give you that blot. That doesn't mean that you should never rebuke somebody ever. That's just a reality of the truth. The reality is, hatred stirreth up strife, my friend. It says, but love covereth all sins. Now I really want to focus on this verse for a minute because this verse, you know, destroys Calvinism all by itself. And you say, how does this one verse by itself destroy Calvinism? Well, let's go to 1 Peter chapter 4. And I'll read for you in 1 John 2. The Bible says, my little children, these things write I unto you that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he's the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. There's your limited atonement destroyed in one verse.
Amen.
But even if you go to Proverbs, it destroys it completely. It says, love covereth all sins. Not just some of them, not just a little bit, all of them. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8, it says, and above all these things have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sins. So the first application here would just be someone you love in this world. Someone like a spouse, or a brother, or a family member. When you love that person, you can just cover all the sins. You can just at one point say, hey, look, I know you screwed up. I know you've done all these wrong things, but I love you, and it doesn't matter. I'm going to forgive you. And you just move on. You just completely forgive and forget. That would be that love covering the sins. Covering a multitude of sins, as it says here. But doesn't it say in 1 John that God is love? So isn't that an interesting thing? God is love. Let that just sink in for a moment. This says, but love covereth all sins. Now, if I were to say, you know, my wife is beautiful, okay? And I think that's true. If I said my wife is beautiful, and then I said my wife is Carrie Shelley, okay? Now, wouldn't it be a completely logical thing for me to take that those two sentences and combine them and say, Carrie Shelley is very beautiful, right? Because Carrie Shelley is my wife. So if God is love, can't we do the same thing here with Proverbs chapter 10? It says, but love covereth all sins. God covereth all sins. You want to know how many sins God covered? All of them.
Amen.
You know, I'm a zero-point Calvinist. I don't believe in any of them. Amen. But limited atonement is so ridiculous, it's so anti-biblical, because God covereth all sins, my friend. All of them. Every single one. And if you believe on Him, you're saved. If you reject Him, you're not. That's what the Bible says. It covers all sins. And you know, I was thinking about the Bible says that Jesus Christ is God, right? We know that God was manifest in the flesh. So you could say Jesus Christ covereth all sins. Amen. You know, the Bible says that Jesus Christ is the Word. You could say that the Word covereth all sins, my friend. Amen. When you understand that God is Jesus Christ, when Jesus Christ is the Word, when you understand that God is love, this Bible will start speaking to you in all kinds of different ways. You can understand so many different things because they mean so many different things. And God is love, my friend, and He covereth all sins. You know, I'm not a one-point Calvinist, a two-point Calvinist. I'm a zero-point Calvinist. You know what I am? A three-point Christian.
Amen.
The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
That's what I believe in. That's what I put my faith and trust in. You know, I'm a thousand-point Christian because I just believe everything this book says. Because love covereth all sins. The Word of God covereth all sins, my friend. It's not, you know, you can go out and just read all these books by John Calvin and John, you know, Charles Spurgeon and John Wesley. I know lots of Baptists that, you know, they're Reformed. And that's all they love to do. They love to get all these books from the 1500s and read them cover to cover. No, I want to read the Word that covereth all sins, my friend.
Amen.
This is the book that changes lives, not some dead heretic that probably went to hell. Because he never believed on the Lord Jesus Christ according to anything he wrote. And why do you know it was a wicked person? By what comes out of their mouth.
Right.
Amen.
Let's go back to Proverbs chapter 10. It says in verse 13, in the lips of him that hath understanding, wisdom is found. But a rod is for the back of him that is void of understanding. Wise men lay up knowledge, but the mouth of the foolish is near destruction. Look, what comes out of your mouth is so important. The lips of him that hath understanding, wisdom is found. You want to find wisdom? Find someone that's speaking the right things. Finding someone that's speaking righteousness, that hath understanding. But a rod is for the back of him that is void of understanding. Those that are foolish, there's nothing that's going to fix them but the rod. They need that physical chastisement, my friend. It says, wise men lay up knowledge, but the mouth of foolish is near destruction. It says, the rich man's wealth is his strong city. The destruction of the poor is their poverty. This rich man's wealth is really all he has in this world. If y'all would turn to Proverbs chapter 18. Proverbs chapter 18. We're going to kind of see the same thing. In Mark chapter 10, the Bible says, and the disciples were astonished at his words. But Jesus answereth again and saith unto them, children, how hard it is for them that trust in riches to enter into the kingdom of God. We see that a rich man, all that he has in this world is his money. And his wealth is this strong city, like the city of Jericho. You know, and there's something that he just can't overcome by physical means. You have to have a spiritual battle to overcome something like that. And in Proverbs chapter 18, verse 11, it says, the rich man's wealth is his strong city. As an high wall is his own conceit. So we get a little bit more insight about this strong city, about what this guy is trusting in. You know, when you have a bunch of money, you have a lot of freedom. You can pretty much just do whatever you want. You can go out and get anything you want. You're protected. You can have a strong tower. You can have a big wall. And they're so conceited to have so much pride in themselves, they think, oh, I'm going to go to heaven because I'm so great. I can provide everything for myself. I don't need a savior. And you know, it's so hard for a rich person to admit that they deserve to go to hell. Or to deserve that they need somebody else to come in and save them. Because they're just so full of their own pride. They're trusting in their riches. They're trusting in their goods. They're relying on themselves. And it says it's a strong city. But it says the destruction of the poor is their poverty. So it's really not good to have a bunch of riches. Because then you start relying on your riches. You start trusting in your riches. You start getting built up on riches. But just so much the more, poverty can be destroyed. The destruction of the poor is their poverty. If we look at Proverbs chapter 6. In Proverbs 28 verse 19 it says, he that tilleth his land shall have plenty of bread, but he that followeth after vain persons shall have poverty enough. The Bible says in Proverbs 20 verse 13, love not sleep, lest thou come to poverty. Open thine eyes, and thou shalt be satisfied with bread. The Bible doesn't talk about poverty as being some great thing to achieve. You know, I've known some people, they dove off in such the wrong direction that they thought poverty was like godliness. They thought like having no money was the best thing ever. No, the Bible's saying work hard and make a living. In Proverbs chapter 6 it says, yet a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to sleep. So shall thy poverty come as one that traveleth, and thy want as an armed man. This isn't a positive thing to be impoverished. That's why in Proverbs chapter 30, you don't have to turn there, the Bible says, remove far from me vanity and lies. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with food convenient for me. You want to go soul winning, you know, just infinitely? You want to go soul winning the most you can in this life? Well, you don't want to have riches because then you're going to be trusting in your riches. You're going to be filled with conceit. You're going to be filled with pride. You're going to say, I don't need God. I don't need to go out soul winning. I don't need the Lord. But just as much, poverty can cause destruction in your life, my friend. You can be like, I can't go out soul winning because I need to go get a job so I can have some money. Or, you know, you might have something befall you because you don't have any money. Destruction can come on the impoverished. Maybe a rich man comes in and takes all your goods, takes you off the jail because you have so much debt. Takes you off the jail because you can't provide for your family. Maybe your wife leaves you because you can't provide for her. Having poverty is not a good thing, my friend. Give me neither poverty nor riches. It's so important to do the right things, to work hard so that you can do the things for the Lord. God wants you to work hard so you can serve Him the best. He's not asking you to work hard just, oh, I want you to have a second job. I just want you to just do this extra stuff too. No, He wants you to work hard so that you can fulfill the kingdom. He wants you to work hard so you can have money to give it to the church so the church can exist, my friend. He wants you to work hard so that you can serve Him. And we shouldn't be consumed with the idea of, oh, I want to be super rich. Or, man, I don't want to have any money ever. I want to rely on people. You know, God's going to, you know, give me food. I'm just going to freeload on other people. No, you should work hard, my friend.
Right.
You shouldn't just walk around thinking, oh, God's going to take care of me, and not work hard. The Bible makes it clear that poverty will come upon you.
Right.
In verse chapter 16, it says, I'm sorry, in chapter 10, verse 16, it says, the labor of the righteous tendeth to life, the fruit of the wicked to sin. Look, what is the righteous laboring to do? Win people to Christ. It tendeth to life, my friend, but the fruit of the wicked is to sin. The only thing that comes about from a wicked person is sin. All they can do is sin. All they can do is think about sin. Their eyes are just focused on sin. The only thing that they can bring forth is sin. It says, he is in the way of life that keepeth instruction, but he that refuseth reproof erreth. And we look so many other places in Proverbs that a wise man will hearken unto instruction, but a foolish man will reject reproof. It says, he that hideth hatred with lying lips, and he that uttereth a slander is a fool. Now this verse is really interesting to me, because it says, he that hideth hatred with lying lips. You know, this hate speech that's going around in this country, that's so prevalent and just about everywhere. It's so false, because the Bible says if you hide hatred with lying lips, you're a fool, my friend. You know, if there's somebody that you hate in this world, it should be known. Let me make this known. I hate child molesters. I hate pedophiles.
Amen.
I hate them. And I'm not going to hide that with lying lips. And you know, you're a fool if there's somebody in this world that you hate and you're not going to be vocal about it. That you're not going to say it. Now, of course, you shouldn't just go around to people and be like, man, I hate you. You know, just to their face. You're going to get a blot. You're going to get a reproach. I mean, no. But you should make it known where you stand. If our government knew that everybody hates child molesters and rapists, I mean, look, our country's laws would probably be a lot different, right, my friend?
That's right.
Open rebuke is better than secret love.
Amen.
And if there's somebody in your life that you hate, it should be known. You don't have to go around, you know, parading about it. And of course, if your whole life is just consumed with hatred, that's wrong. The Bible says that we're supposed to be meek unto other people. We're supposed to be loving. We're supposed to love our neighbor as ourselves. But look, there are things to hate in this world, my friend. And if you're going to hide that with lying lips, you're a fool. If there's some wicked person in your family, that should be known. If there was some sodomite reprobate or some child molester, it should be known that you hate them. Otherwise, you're a fool, according to this chapter. You shouldn't just hide that. You shouldn't just conceal that. You should make your intentions known. You should make the Bible known. Now, of course, we shouldn't hate people without a cause. We shouldn't just hate people because we don't like them. No, we should love our neighbor as ourselves. The only people the Bible really gives any kind of credence to hating would be those that hate the Lord. Those that would have rejected the Lord. They hate the Lord. They gnash on him with their teeth. They say, there is no God. I hate God. I hate Jesus Christ. Someone that's filled with vile affections, that would hurt little children, that would hurt people, that's a predator. Those are the kind of people that we should hate, according to the Bible.
Yeah.
But you know, just somebody at your job that, you know, maybe lied about you or said something mean to you, you should love that person. Mm-hmm. You should hope that they get saved. Mm-hmm. You know, all the people in South Africa that didn't want you to come, didn't want our church to go there, but aren't just some reprobate, we should love them and want them to be saved. Just like the city of Nineveh. You know, Jonah looked at the city of Nineveh and was like, all those wicked, evil, you know, murderous people. I don't want to go over there because I know you're merciful, God. I know you'll give them salvation. I don't want to go. I don't like them. I don't like the Muslims. I don't like the Jews. I don't like the Asians. I don't like the Mexicans. I just want them to go to hell. That's what a lot of people think, my friend. There's a lot of churches where if you went around, you said, hey, should we just bomb the Middle East? You'd be like, oh, yeah.
Right.
And you say, hey, if you don't believe in Christ, would you go to hell? Yeah. Do any of them believe in Christ? No. They literally want millions and billions of people to go to hell, my friend.
Right.
And that is unbiblical. But you should never conceal hate within your heart. We should make it known those that we hate. Those that the Bible says that the hatred is justified. Because they hate the Lord. It says that he that uttereth a slander is a fool. So there's a warning there, though. Even though we're supposed to hate people, we should never be a slanderer. And know what's a slander? A slanderer would be when you say something evil about somebody, but it's not true. Maybe you just heard it on the internet. I know a lot of people, even in this church, that will just repeat things on the internet, and it's not true, my friend. You should never be a slanderer because you're just going to look like a fool. When you post that thing on Facebook and it just turns out to be a lie, people are like, man, that guy's just an idiot. He'll just fall for whatever.
Right.
How much credence does that lose for people outside of our church? They say, oh, look at that guy. He's just slandering people. He's just saying all kinds of wicked things about this person. He doesn't even know the truth. He never even took 2 seconds to read the article. He never looked up any information. He's just slandering people. That brings a reproach unto Christ, my friend.
Yeah.
You're a fool if you're just going to repost something without reading it. You should never just slander somebody for unknown reasons. But look, if the Bible has like 30 verses clearly backing up what you're saying, and you know for sure that it's right, you shouldn't cover that up with lying lips. You shouldn't be like, oh, I love President Obama. He's great. You know? I mean, he's my best friend. No, you should make it known who you hate, my friend. Let's go to verse 19. In the multitude of words there wanteth not sin, but he that refraineth his lips is wise. The Bible's saying, look, if you were to just say a whole bunch of words, that's not sinful. It's not sinful to speak a lot or to have some big speech or use a lot of words. But the warning is, but he that refraineth his lips is wise. The Bible talks over and over and over about the fool just constantly just saying whatever comes on his mind, just uttering everything that comes out of his heart. But a wise man will refrain his lips. He will not just speak whatever comes to his mind. And maybe, what are you like? When you're around your friends, you just every thought that comes to your mind, you're just like, oh, I just want to tell people, oh, I just want to say this. Oh, this thought came to mind, oh, I just want to say it. That's a foolish thing, my friend. A wise thing is to refrain your lips, to not just utter everything that comes to your mind. To think about what you're saying. To think about if it's biblical. To think about if I should be saying this. So you're not just slandering people. So you're not just saying stupid, foolish things. We return to James chapter 3. James chapter 3. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 7, a time to rend and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. There's times when you need to keep silence. Have you ever thought to yourself, oh, I need to keep silence right now. If you haven't had that thought, you need to have that thought, my friend. There's plenty of times to keep silence. There's times to be prudent. Let's say somebody came into the church and they weren't saved. And let's say they had long hair and they were dressed wrong and you could tell they were really worldly. Should you just go through and just name every sin that you can possibly think of, like looking at that person? No, you should refrain your lips, my friend. You should preach him Christ first. Get him saved. Give him some good instruction. And then slowly show him what the Bible says. You should have some prudence, some wisdom to these situations. It says in James chapter 3, verse 7, for every kind of beast and of birds and of serpents and of things in the sea is tamed and hath been tamed of mankind. But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. The Bible says no man can tame his tongue. So if you already know that it's impossible for you to tame your tongue, how much more then should you refrain your lips? Should you be a wise person and not just utter every thought that comes to your mind? The Bible says in Ecclesiastes 5, be not rash with thy mouth, and let not thine heart be hasty to utter anything before God. For God is in heaven, and thou upon earth. Therefore, let thy words be few. Have you ever had that thought? Have you ever had the thought, man, I should have few words? It's a sobering thought sometimes to think about. It says in Proverbs chapter 17, he that hath knowledge spareth his words, and a man of understanding is an of excellent spirit. Even a fool, when he holdeth his peace, is counted wise. And he that shutteth his lips is esteemed a man of understanding. Look, the Bible's saying, even a fool, if he were to just stand there and just kind of be quiet and paying attention, a lot of people would be like, that guy seems pretty smart. You know, that guy must understand what's going on. But someone that's just uttering everything that's coming out of his mouth, 99% of the time, you're just going to be like, that guy's kind of a fool. That guy doesn't have much awareness about himself. That guy's not very learned. He's not a wise person. The Bible says in verse 20 of chapter 10, the tongue of the just is choice silver. The heart of the wicked is little worth. What do you think about all the politicians in America? Little worth?
Yeah.
The lips of the righteous feed many, but fools die for want of wisdom. Look, the lips of the righteous feed many. How much more did the people who got fed the 5,000, you know, the 5,000 were fed by Jesus Christ with the food, do you think they went home talking about that? Or the long, all-day sermons from Jesus Christ? Look, my friend, that was probably a pretty cool meal, but even the disciples forgot about it instantly. But the lips of the righteous will feed your soul, my friend. This book will feed your soul. It says, the blessing of the Lord it maketh rich, and he addeth no sorrow with it. Turn, if you would, to Ecclesiastes chapter 5. The Bible says that we can have, you know, wealth and prosperity in this life. God's wealth. You know, the wealth that comes from working hard your whole life and laying up, you know, good inheritance for your children. But the Bible says in Ecclesiastes 5, verse 12, the sleep of a laboring man is sweet, whether he eat little or much. But the abundance of the rich will not suffer him to sleep. Those that are just super wealthy and have all this money, by the wisdom of this world, they can't even sleep because they're just so consumed with their money. They're just thinking about, man, what if someone could break in the bank and steal my money? What if the stock market dropped tomorrow and I lost all my money? What if the government passes this law and I lose all my money? What if the American currency gets deflated and I lose all my money? Oh man, I can't sleep. Oh man, I gotta check the Chinese stock market. And oh man, I gotta call and get a new safe. Oh man, I can't sleep because I have all this money and I don't want to lose it. You can't get any sleep, my friend. You really envy that? Man, I love sleep. Man, I can't wait to go to sleep at night. I love getting in bed. And man, when you work really hard, you'll go to sleep like that. I promise, my friend. Man, I go to sleep like that. My wife is so jealous. She's like, man, I fell asleep talking to my wife the other night. We were just sitting there on the couch, and we're like talking, and I just fell asleep. And it was so sweet. You know, you come home and you work really hard. I might even sometimes be like, can I just go sleep? I don't even want to eat dinner. I just want to get some sleep. The sleep of a laboring man is sweet, my friend. But the riches of this world will not cause you to sleep. Let's look at the last section of this chapter. In verse 23 it says, it is sport to a fool to do mischief, but a man of understanding hath wisdom. The fear of the wicked it shall come upon him, but the desire of the righteous shall be granted. As the whirlwind passeth, so is the wicked no more, but the righteous is an everlasting foundation. As vinegar to the teeth, and as smoke to the eyes, so is the sluggard to them that send him. The fear of the Lord prolongeth days, but the years of the wicked shall be shortened. The hope of the righteous shall be gladness, but the expectation of the wicked shall perish. The way of the Lord is strength to the upright, but destruction shall be to the workers of iniquity. The righteous shall never be removed, but the wicked shall not inhabit the earth. The mouth of the just bringeth forth wisdom, but the froward tongue shall be cut out. The lips of the righteous know what is acceptable, but the mouth of the wicked speaketh frowardness. So this last chapter, this last verse, it's going back and talking again about things that are coming out of your mouth. You know, if I was going to sum up this whole chapter, I think it was, but he that refraineth his lips is wise. You want to be different than this world? Refrain your lips, my friend. The fool is just going to speak what comes out of his mouth. It says it is a sport to a fool to do mischief, but a man of understanding hath wisdom. Look, the wicked people in this world, they just want to cause mischief. They want to do evil things. The Bible talks about a man losing his sleep unless he's done some kind of mischief. It says the wicked want to do evil. But look in verse 24, it says the fear of the wicked, it shall come upon him, but the desire of the righteous shall be granted. Look, all the things that the wicked man fears, they're going to come upon him. He's like, man, I'm going to lose all my money. Oh, he's going to lose all his money. He's worried about all the death, destruction, murder. He's worried about going to hell. And look, my friend, I don't care what these people say. They know there's a God. They know there's judgment. They know there's a hell. And in the back of their mind, they're like, man, I'm so afraid that if I died, I'd go to hell. And that's going to come upon him. If he doesn't believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. God will give you the desires of your heart, though, if you seek him. That's what it says in the back. It says, but the desire of the righteous shall be granted. Look, if you're faithful unto God, if you're doing what he's saying, isn't he going to just want to give you the desires of your heart? I mean, think of the father and the son that we had at the beginning. That wise son. When a father sees his wise son doing what he's saying, you know, following his commandments, he's like, man, I just want to give him what he wants. I want to give him the desires of his heart. I want him to be blessed. Do you think God wants a faithful soul winner that's going out and living righteous to be destroyed? I mean, how many people are there in this world that are doing that? God's going to preserve that man. God's going to make sure that his angels are protecting that guy. How much more should you want to desire to be that? Desire to be that righteous man. Turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. It says in verse 25, as a whirlwind passeth, so is the wicked no more. But the righteous is an everlasting foundation. So it's saying, just as a whirlwind will just go by real quick, so is the wicked no more. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 3, the Bible says, for when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them, as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. That's just an interesting thing that he's picturing. You know, me and my wife, we had our first child in the hospital, and we were going to have our second child in the hospital because we had already paid for it. We kind of changed our minds. We're like, man, I think we're going to start doing the home birth. It seems like it's maybe a little bit better. We didn't really like some of the things about the hospital and what they were doing. But since we had already paid for it, and she wasn't going to get the epidural or do any of the shots or any of that kind of stuff, we're like, we'll still use it. It'll still be what we wanted. But we were getting closer, and we didn't really know what to expect because she had gotten epidural the first time. So she couldn't really feel it. And we went to sleep, and she wakes me up in the middle of the night, and it's like 2 a.m., and she's like, I'm having contractions, and they're like 30 seconds apart. And I was like, whoa, that means you're like about to have a baby. I was like, ah, she's probably exaggerating. This isn't, you know, really happening. So I get up, and I'm like, what do I do? She's like, oh, let's, I was like, I'll call the hospital. So I call them, they say, hey, just put her in a bath. If it keeps increasing, come in right away. If not, just wait a little bit. So I get a bath, she's getting in there, and I'm just like packing like furiously. I'm just like throwing stuff, and like running to the kitchen, and I'm like trying to get stuff. And as like every like minute or 30 seconds, she starts screaming a little bit more. She's like, and then eventually it turns to, oh no, he's coming. And I'm like, crap, what is happening? So I come and I'm like, no, we can make it. We can get there. And so I like call her mom. I'm like, we're going to the hospital right now. And so she gets out and she's like, no, it's happening. She gets on the bed and I'm like, what do I do? And she's like, call 911. So I'm like calling, I'm like on the phone, and they just put me on hold right away. You know, really good service. So I'm on hold, and then literally, it was happening, my friend. It was happening, and we had our baby. And the Bible says, it's saying here, I'm sorry, I lost my place. It says, as sudden destruction cometh upon them, as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. Look, every woman that's been pregnant has given birth. It always happens. You know, she can't escape that moment. When we were in that moment, we wanted to hit the pause button, and we wanted to find a place like a doctor, a hospital, something, but we couldn't. We couldn't escape. And the wicked, sudden destruction will come upon them, and there will be no escape. Look in verse 26, it says, as vinegar to the teeth, and as smoke to the eyes, so is the sluggard to them that send it. You know, maybe I'm just picking on my wife a lot tonight, but, you know, she ended up getting a kidney stone not too long ago. It's one of the worst experiences ever. And so we were trying to do some, like, holistic approaches to, like, help this. And I read somewhere, like, if you drink apple cider vinegar, like, that would kind of help or something. And so I just gave her, like, I thought, well, maybe it'd just be better to just take all of it once in one big gulp. Instead of putting, like, watering it down. You know, and then chasing. So she got, like, I gave her, like, I don't know, a couple ounces. And she just like whipped it back and then just spit it out. Because it was like, this burns, it hurts so much. It was awful, it was wicked. You know, it's just like, as vinegar to the teeth and as smoke to the eyes, so is the sluggard to them that send it. Look, when you have a job to be done, and you're like, oh, I really need this job to get done. I really need to send this work, or I need to really get this thing done. And the only guy there, you know, just is so lazy. You're just like, God, I don't want to send him. Man, it's so awful. It's like vinegar to the teeth. It's like smoke to the eyes. Is that you? Are you the person that someone would think that about? The person that's a sluggard? Would your boss look at you and say, oh man, I just hate giving him work because he never gets it done. Because he never does a good job. Because he's a sluggard. Because he's slothful. Because he's wasteful. It's so awful for someone to have to get somebody to help them, to motivate them. Isn't one of the worst things just apathy? You're talking to somebody at the door, and you're like, if you die today, are you 100% sure you go to heaven? I don't know. You know? I don't really care. I mean, who cares? Whatever. It's like impossible to get that person saved when they're just so apathetic, when they just don't even care. I'd rather the person just tell me no. I'd rather the person be cold or hot, not lukewarm, my friend. Go to verse 27. The fear of the Lord prolongeth days, but the years of the wicked shall be shortened. Look, when you follow God's laws, when you follow the commandments, you're going to have long life. When you don't, you're not. I looked up this article. It's from Australia. It was the 6 deadly sins. Now, this is not an independent fundamental Baptist paper. This is not even a Christian paper. This is just a bunch of researchers. And they were studying the 6 worst habits that you could have in your life that would shorten your days. So let's see what they said. First one, alcohol. Second one, poor diet. Third one, inactivity. Fourth one, smoking. Fifth one, sitting too much. Sixth one, sleeping. Sleeping way too much. Now, what in the world did we just read in this chapter? I mean, we didn't cover alcohol necessarily, but if you read the book of Proverbs, it's going to mention these 6 over and over and over. Man, it's not even a shock to me. I read this, I wasn't like, oh, that's surprising. No, because the Word of God is true, my friend. How in the world could you look at this book, which just has all the wisdom and all the truth in the world, and it's just confirmed over and over and over, and be like, oh, just some peasants, you know, some old cavemen just wrote that stuff. Of course not, my friend. And the Bible is truer than the day is long. If you want to have a length of days, follow His commandments. Amen. If you don't, just lay around, do nothing, just drink alcohol, whatever. You're going to lose a lot of days on your life. The leading researcher, Dr. Melanie Dean from the University of Sydney, said, short and long sleep durations were separated as 2 different risk factors, as their associations with mortality may be explained by different mechanisms. So she said, look, if you get like no sleep, that's going to be really hazardous to your health. And if you get a lot of sleep, that's going to be really hazardous to your health, according to even scientific research. I mean, the Bible's saying, look, when you're just sleeping all the time, when you're so lazy, poverty's going to come upon you, my friend, and you're going to lose the length of days. Verse 28, the Bible says, the hope of the righteous shall be gladness, but the expectation of the wicked shall perish. Look, what are we hoping for? Jesus Christ. Our hope and our eternal glory, the Lord Jesus Christ. Doesn't that just bring gladness to your heart? Yeah. To know that one day we're going to live in a better earth, have a better body. But it says, but the expectation of the wicked shall perish. I want to focus on this verse for just a minute. I was thinking about the expectation of the wicked. Now we're in a season that's pretty interesting in America every 4 years. We have a lot of expectations for the future, right? A lot of political expectations. You know, I was really challenged by somebody that is not saved on the Hillary Clinton. I heard someone say, I think Hillary Clinton's the most wicked person on the face of this planet. And I was like, I agree. But I didn't say anything because I was just listening to this conversation. And the next guy said, well, how do you know that? How can you prove that? And he's like, well, look at all the speculation of, you know, all these murders surrounding her political career, and looking at Benghazi, and look at all these things. And he's like, yeah, but there's no verifiable evidence to prove any of those. So you don't know if it's a slander or not. And to be honest, I believe that there's a lot of nefarious things she's done, but I'll give him credit to the fact that I can't verify any of those things. So how do I know, how can I say I do agree with them that Hillary Clinton is the wickedest person on the face of this planet? Well, what have we been following in this book of the Proverbs? How do you know if someone's wicked? By what comes out of their mouth, right? So why don't I just go to HillaryClinton.com and see what she says? See what her expectations are for the future. And you know, I don't even believe the presidential election's real anymore. I think they just hand-select whoever they want. And I think Hillary Clinton's probably just going to be selected. So I was like, I might as well read up what America's going to be like. You know, what she wants it to be like, at least. It says the expectation of the wicked shall perish, though. You say, well, why aren't you picking on Donald Trump? You know, why aren't you picking on him? Well, that's because he flips on every single issue. I couldn't even come up here and say this is what Donald Trump believes, because he doesn't believe anything. There's some video that says like Trump versus Trump, and he said these are the things that he just completely flip-flops on. He flips up on Russia. He flips up on being a Republican or a Democrat. He says he loves Mitt Romney. He hates Mitt Romney. He loves Hillary Clinton. He hates Hillary Clinton. He loves debt. He wants to eliminate debt. He says he loves Iowa. He hates Iowa. He loves Ted Cruz. He hates Ted Cruz. He thinks Japan should have nukes. He doesn't think Japan should have nukes. He's pro-choice. He's pro-life. That's a contradiction. He's for the Afghanistan war. He thought that was a good idea. Oh, no, I think that was a bad idea. He's for custom. He gets up and he says, oh, that Mexican president, he was cussing. And then he just says like every four-letter word in the dictionary. Look, the guy's the biggest hypocrite I've ever heard of. He's for health care. He's against the health care, Affordable Care Act. He's against Libya and what they're doing. He's for Libya. He said that he's for immigration. He doesn't want to separate the families. And he said, no, I want to separate them and send them back. He said both things. He's for minimum wage. He wants to lower the minimum wage. He wants to show his tax returns. He doesn't. Look, I can't even. What am I going to do? He flip-flops on every issue. That's why I don't want to attack him, because he doesn't believe anything. What do I expect from Donald Trump? I have no idea, but it's not going to be good. That's all I know. He changes his mind more than he changes his wives. Did you hear me? He changes his mind more than his wives. So I'm going to pick on Hillary Clinton, and I have the 13 reasons why Hillary Clinton is wicked as hell. And you know, I'm not getting this based on some speculation. I'm not getting this on some, I found this on some website that, against Hillary Clinton. No, this is HillaryClinton.com. This is a pro, you get on the site, and it's just this big picture of Donald Trump, and it's like, click here if you hate Donald Trump. Like, it's like, what in the world? Here's number one. She has 40 categories that she covers. And in each category, she has like 5 or 6 points. So she has like 200 issues. And that's the first problem. It's not even on this list, but that's the first problem with Hillary Clinton and this government, is they want to be Superman. They want to be in charge of every issue.
Right.
They want to be in charge of the whole world. They want to have an opinion on everything. They want to be in complete control.
Yeah.
That's not even point one. Point one is she wants to raise the minimum wage and strengthen overtime rules. Hillary Clinton wants to raise the minimum wage to $12 in the entire nation as a federal law, and then even raise it to $15 in certain states. You know what it's going to do? That's going to make a lot of people lose their job. A lot of people are going to lose their job. Companies are going to find out ways to do things without humans. Just automate everything. And that's just going to start to eliminate the middle class. It's not going to actually help anybody. It's just going to hurt the economy. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 30, verse 8, remove far from me vanity and lies. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with food convenient for me. We shouldn't be, so focused on... on wanting to be poor or to be rich. And Hillary Clinton wants to affect all of that. She only wants people to be poor or rich. What does the Bible say? You want to be middle class, right? But Hillary Clinton wants to destroy the middle class. She only wants there to be these few rich people and these few poor people. Exactly what the Bible says you don't want. You don't want to be super rich and you don't want to be super poor. And she wants to eliminate that with the minimum wage. And I'm not going to explain all the economics and all that. But trust me, my friend, it will destroy the middle class. Number two, she wants to make debt-free college available to all Americans. And I'm reading this verbatim what's on her website. She wants to make college completely free to Americans. Now, who's going to pay for that? Who's going to pay for that? The Americans. So how in the world is it going to be free? It's not free. It's just going to give them more and more money to be completely inefficient with and just brainwash the children, brainwash everybody. They want people to go to college because, look, most of the kids on college won't have anything to do with God. Yeah. Most people in their life, if you ask them, you say, when are you least spiritual in your life? It was when they were in college. They're just focused on, lying with each other and evolution and all the philosophies of this world and partying and just having fun. They're not interested in anything that's real. Having a job, working hard, having a family, going to church, not interested. But she wants to make sure all kids get to go do that experience. Number three, she wants to protect and expand on the Affordable Care Act. She says, which has helped address discrimination in our healthcare system and brought health coverage to millions more women. Well, I don't believe that's true. My wife used to have healthcare coverage, and now she doesn't because of the Affordable Care Act. Because insurance rates have skyrocketed.
Yep.
Because it's so impossible to even want to pay for this junk.
That's right.
It's like a $15,000 deductible, and they only cover like 80% after that. And then I have to pay like $600 a month to buy it. So if you calculate all that, even if she were to have some catastrophic event, it'd have to be like 30 or 40 grand for me even to like kind of start making some money on the deal. Well, look, if I just save 30 or 40 grand every year for the rest of our lives, I'm sure I could pay every medical bill, my friend. And look, even if we're protect against some catastrophic event, most of these places have some kind of debt forgiveness or something. This Affordable Care Act is a fraud. They just want to get more control. They want to destroy capitalism. They want to infringe on your rights as an American. You shouldn't be forced to buy health insurance.
Right, okay, right.
And I've had to pay the penalty every single year in some form or fashion.
Yep.
And I will continue to do it as long as they infringe on my rights. It says, number four, she wants to expand background checks to more gun sales. Says that she wants to close the gun shows and internet sale loopholes and strengthen background check systems to get rid of the so-called Charleston loophole. Now the thing about this is they try to bring this as a real pretty package. They say, well, you don't think that a convicted rapist murderer should be able to buy a gun? And you're like, well, I agree. Like, maybe that is a good rule. But guess what? They want to increase their background checks to just deny guns to whoever they want. It's not a giant leap to decide, hey, we don't like Christians because they don't like homosexuals and they're against this hate speech. We're not going to let them buy guns. Mm-hmm. Look, you shouldn't let the government just decide whoever can buy or own a gun, because that infringes on the Constitution. We have the right to bear arms. And it doesn't say unless the government decides that you shouldn't have one because you went to jail one time. What if you went to jail for soul winning and you became a felon and you couldn't have a gun? I mean, you think that's that far-fetched, my friend? Look, this stuff is not constitutional, it's not biblical, and she's wicked as hell. We're just getting started. Number five, she wants to make environmental justice and climate justice central priorities. She wants the environment and the climate to be central priorities to the government. How stupid and ignorant is she? It says in Proverbs chapter 8, verse 31, rejoicing in the habitable part of his earth, and my delights with the sons of men. Again, I don't think she really wants that. I think she just wants more government programs so that she can bring in more money and she can buy off more people. God wants us to rejoice in the habitable part of his earth. We're supposed to be filled into the habitable parts of this planet. And there's parts that aren't habitable. We shouldn't be concerned with them. And you know, she wants to just increase all kinds of forests and all kinds of places that are habitable. God wants us to, I mean, there's so much of the earth that's not habitable.
Right.
We should fill up the habitable places.
That's right.
You know, there's nothing wrong with tearing down a forest and building a city. There's nothing wrong with it according to the Bible. God wants us, I mean, at the beginning, that's all they did. They weren't going out and finding cities. No, they're going out building cities. There's nothing wrong with building more cities. We shouldn't just be restricting our habitable place to, oh, we can only live in this one little square that they have a big wall built around that they can keep us locked in. Number six, she wants to dismantle the school-to-prison pipeline. Now that sounds good on the surface, right? I mean, don't want people just going straight from school to prison. She says schools should be safe places for students to learn and grow, but in too many communities, student discipline is overly harsh. And these harsh measures disproportionately affect African American students and those with the greatest economic, social, and academic needs. Hillary will work to dismantle the school-to-prison pipeline by providing $2 billion in support to schools to reform overly punitive disciplinary policies, calling on states to reform school disturbance laws, and encouraging states to use federal education funding to implement social and emotional support interventions. You know what she wants to do? She wants to replace the paddle with some psychologist. She wants to get rid of any kind of punishment in the schools. Now, is that a good idea according to Proverbs? He that withholdeth correction from his son hates his son, according to the Bible, right? He that spareth the rod hateth his son. We need, and the Bible talks about the rod being for the fool. That's not talking about a kid, that's talking about an adult. You want to have less wickedness? You want to have less people in prison, Hillary? You need to have the rod for the back of the fool. You don't need to have less punishment. That's so contradictory. Number seven, she proudly stands with Planned Parenthood. Hillary is proud to have earned the endorsement of Planned Parenthood Action Fund. She will always defend the essential health and reproductive care that Planned Parenthood provides for women. Now, there's nothing proud about murdering babies.
No, I don't.
It's the wicked as hell. You want to know why Hillary Clinton is so wicked? She not only wants to kill babies, she's proud of it. And look, if there was some woman that had done that in her past and she repented, we should forgive her. And we shouldn't hold that against her. But if you're proud of it, you need to just get out of this church. You need to just get out of all churches. You shouldn't be welcome on this planet, my friend.
Yeah.
We shouldn't be murdering babies, murdering children, and then be proud of it. I've seen people that have shirts that say they're proud that they have an abortion. How wicked as hell is our country? Why do you think there's so much judgment on our nation when we have people walking around in that filth?
Amen.
You know what? My hatred wouldn't be hide with lying lips if I saw someone like that. Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 15, the Bible says, y'all can turn there. I'll go to the next one, then I'll read it. It says the eighth point, promote women's rights around the globe. In far too many parts of the world, women are still held back by social, economic, and legal barriers. Hillary will promote gender equality around the world. You think Pastor Anderson's lying when he says that America is promoting their filth across this world? No, she's saying it right here. She's saying she wants to bring feminism to all other countries. She wants to make sure that feminism is brought to, you know, Islam and all these other countries. And obviously, Islam is a wicked religion, but at least they have a couple things right. She wants to ruin those too. She wants to get rid of everything that's good. And of course, a woman wants to bring that. In Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 15, the Bible says, were they ashamed when they had committed abomination? Nay, they were not ashamed, neither could they blush. Therefore they shall fall among them that fall. At the time that I visit them, they shall be cast down, saith the Lord. Thus saith the Lord, stand ye in the ways and see, and ask for the old paths, wherein is the good way, and walk therein. And ye shall find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk therein. We should be ashamed of our country. But you know, Hillary's not ashamed of it. She's proud of it. She loves the abortion. She loves the filth. She wants to promote that across the whole world. Because she wants to kill babies in the whole world. She doesn't want to just kill them here. She wants to kill all of them. Number nine. She wants to fight for an AIDS-free generation. Now, I can get behind that idea. I want an AIDS-free generation. But how in the world is she going to get that? She wants to get that by protecting transgender rights. She wants to protect all the freaks that mutilate their body. That was number 10. Number 11, she wants to work to fully implement the national HIV and AIDS strategy. You want to know how you're going to have an AIDS-free generation? Leviticus 20:13, my friend. Leviticus 20:13. It says, if a man also lie with mankind, as he lieth with a woman, both of them have committed an abomination, they shall surely be put to death. Their blood shall be upon them. That's how you have an AIDS-free generation. But she's not going to get it by protecting all these freaks and all these transgender people, by implementing a national HIV-AIDS strategy. She wants to come up with some vaccine that people can inject in their body that'll give them less likelihood to get AIDS. I mean, these people are they're just laughing all the way to the bank. They're like, yeah, get our vaccine and you won't get AIDS. No, it's the judgment of God, my friend. Amen. And there ain't any vaccine against that. Turn to Romans chapter 1. She says in number 12, she wants to reform outdated, stigmatizing HIV criminalization laws. Now, there's still a lot of laws on the book that if you have AIDS, if you have HIV, it's a law, if you're bleeding, to just come up to somebody and let that blood get on them. You would go to jail for that. Or to spit on somebody with blood. Or to go to the blood bank and donate blood knowing that you have that filthy, disgusting disease. That's a law on our books. But she wants to get rid of that. Because she doesn't want anybody to be offended. Man, if you have that disgusting blood, I don't want to see you anywhere near me.
Amen.
Right. Man. Romans chapter 1, it says, verse 29, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whispers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. You know, the Bible's talking about the most wicked, evil, filthy, disgusting people. It says that they have pleasure in it. You want to know how I know Hillary Clinton's so wicked? Because she has pleasure in wickedness, my friend. She has pleasure in this abortion and this sodomy and all this filth. Here's number 13. She wants to promote human rights of the LGBT people around the world. She says with her mouth, she wants to promote sodomy to this entire world. She says Hillary will promote LGBT human rights and ensure Americans' foreign policy is inclusive of LGBT people, including increasing our investment in the Global Equality Fund to advance human rights. That sounds like the fund that gave money to the gay SA radio to get Pastor Henderson kicked out of South Africa.
Amen.
That's wicked as hell, my friend.
Amen.
And you say, oh, I don't think that's really happening. Oh, I don't think our government's really taking us in that direction. Look, my friend, it's in black and white on her website. She's wanting to promote this filth and disgustingness. It says later in this section, it says, in the U.S. Senate, Hillary championed legislation to address hate crimes, fought for federal non-discrimination legislation to reject LGBT Americans in the workplace, and advocate for an end to restrictions that blocked LGBT Americans from adopting children. Look, she wants to make laws that criminalize hate speech against homos. And then she wants to give them children. Can you think of something worse than giving a sodomite a child? I was looking up some statistics. I don't recommend doing this. It was looking at statistics of people that would molest children, of pedophiles. And when they would catch one, our laws are so wicked. Somebody could get caught and be in and out of jail in 3 months. And guess what? They're just going to do it again. And when they caught one of these people, they found out that the average number of victims of a child molester is 18. 18 children. 18 children that they would hurt and harm. Look, how about after the first one? Just kill them, my friend.
Amen.
How about the 10th one? You're like, I don't know. Let's get them, keep going. Let's just let them. How many children do you want to hurt and harm? But you know, they did a study. They found out of child molesters that are homosexual in nature, that are men with men, their average number of victims is 152 children. 152 children. Oh, I don't think it's right to hate people. Do you just hate 152 children? That's disgusting. That's filthy. That's why they're reprobate, my friend. You want to know why they're not saved? They're filled with all unrighteousness, all wickedness.
Amen.
And then she says, hey, I want to get rid of laws that give these people children. What a fool. What a just so wicked person. You know, the first couple to ever adopt children was a couple in Europe. And it came to find out that the 12 children that they adopted, they molested all of them. Every single one of them. What a shock! I mean, the Bible's so clear on the subject, my friend. The Bible is full of truth. And she wants to give children to the LGBT community. Our nation is headed in a really dark road, my friend. And we need to be vocal. We need to make sure that the righteousness of God is being preached. She says that she wants to help implement LGBT-friendly workplace policies and updated the State Department's policy so that transgender individuals' passports reflect their true gender. She wants to make it where the passport of one of these people that mutilates themselves says that they mutilated themselves. What in the world? I mean, what kind of world are we living in that people are so delusional to think, hey, if I chop off my arm, maybe I'm a tree? I mean, you can't change your DNA, my friend.
Amen.
If you're a male, you're a male. If you're a female, you're a female. It doesn't change whether or not you chop off part of your body.
That's right.
Or you glue something on. Oh man, I glue on some leaf. I'm a tree now. Oh yeah! It's ridiculous. But look, she literally wants to have legislation that your passport, I mean, probably one of the most lifted up documents in this world, right? I mean, one of the most important documents, she wants it to be able to say that you're some weird freak. Why? Because it helps promote it across the world. Because when you travel, you have to use what? A passport. And they want the whole world to be exposed to their filth and their disgusting nastiness. That's how they're promoting it. Turn to Ephesians chapter 5. You want to know what the 13 reasons why I believe Hillary Clinton's so wicked? Just go to her website. There's hundreds more. I didn't cover everything. I couldn't cover everything. But look, why do I think Hillary Clinton's wicked as hell? Because of the words that come out of her mouth. But he that refraineth his lips is wise. We shouldn't be like the wicked people that just utter everything that comes to our mind, all of the wicked sin, all of the filth. In Ephesians 5, chapter, verse 14, it says, wherefore he saith, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Wake up, America! Wake up!
Amen.
You really want our 152 children to be molested by these pedophiles? Do you really want children to be murdered by their own parents? Why in the world are we promoting this filth and this wickedness? We should be exposing the truth. I guarantee that if people, you know, these people that are like, oh, I'll vote for Hillary. if you really expose to them the truth of what she wants, right. If you're like, do you really want 152 children to be molested? Do you really want children to be brutally murdered? What happens in the abortion clinics? These people might be like, whoa, like maybe it's not that cool to vote for Hillary. Wow, these people are pretty wicked. You know, but people are going to come, hey, did you hear about this one guy that might have died, and he was over in this one country, and, you know, there wasn't this much evidence, and there was this one email, and they're like, just give it up. I'm going to vote for Hillary. Why don't you focus on the things that come out of her mouth, the real things that you can prove? I was challenged by this guy. He was like, why do you hate Hillary Clinton? Why is Hillary Clinton wicked? And I was like, well, I know she is, but I'm not exactly sure. We should understand
right.
Why we would hate somebody. Mm-hmm. And not just slander against them, not just say wicked things. In Isaiah chapter 3 it says, woe unto the wicked, it shall be ill with him, for the reward of his hand shall be given him. As for my people, children are their oppressors, and women rule over them. O my people, they which lead thee to cause thee to err, and destroy the ways of thy paths. When God was talking about his people suffering punishment, he said it's when a woman's ruling over you. Isn't it just a shame when a woman's in charge, when a woman's ruling over the nation? And it's not to talk down on women. The shame is that there's not a man to stand in the gap. That there's not a man willing to get up and do what's right, to lead this nation, to go after righteousness. And it's not Donald Trump, my friend. He's just like the other women. And Hillary Clinton wants to stand up. I'll stand up. You know, there's places in the Bible where a woman stands up and she does something good or she does something right. It was just a shame because there wasn't a man to do it, my friend.
Right.
I bet there's plenty of righteous women that could give up a pretty decent sermon. But why is that wrong? Because there needs to be a man to get up and preach. Okay. It would be a shame if there wasn't a man in this room that could get up and preach the Bible. And a man should be the one leading because that's what God said.
Right.
Let's look at verse 29. It says, in the way of the Lord is strength to the upright. But destruction shall be to the workers of iniquity. Christ will keep you strong. The Bible will keep you strong. You know, we looked at the six deadly sins. I kind of read them for you, right? I was thinking about, you know, some people might think, well, it's not that important to work out and to maybe eat right and to live a healthy life. But God's commandments will keep you strong. And I was thinking about Brother Gary. You know, he's kind of an older gentleman. I've heard that he's 50 years old. I don't know. I think he is 50 years old, right? Yeah. He looks strong as an ox, my friend. And he can go out and he can preach the gospel with the best of them. Yeah. He can go out and preach for 5-6 hours. He can walk up and down the streets. He's got a lot of life in him. You know, and at the age of 19 and 20 and maybe even to your late 20s, sometimes we take for granted our strength.
True.
Because you can just destroy your body and live however you want. And even in your 20s, you can go out and walk and do whatever you want. But how much of a shame would it be if you're 50 years old and you couldn't go out walking? If you didn't have the strength of your legs? If you weren't, you know, weren't healthy? And you're like, man, I want to go out and preach the gospel, but I can't. Because I just don't have the strength. God will give you the strength if you follow His commandments.
Amen.
If you do what He says. I don't think you should eat healthy because of any reason other than just preserving your life. The Bible talks about in Ecclesiastes at the end of the chapter. It says, wherefore I perceive that there is nothing better than that a man should rejoice in his own works, for that is his portion. For who shall bring him to see what shall be after him? Look, the only thing you have in this world is your works. You get saved and you get to go to heaven. But then the way you live your life, your works, that's your portion. So why don't you live your whole life getting your works, building riches, being rich towards God?
Right.
How are you going to do that? By following His commandments? By keeping yourself strong, by living a good and long life. You know, I don't care if my wife works out for vanity's sake. Who cares? I think my wife's gorgeous. She'll always be gorgeous. But you know what? It would be a shame if either one of us decided to forsake our health, and then when we were later in our years, we're just sitting around at home. How many people have you seen that are just shut-ins? When you go out soul winning, when you knock on doors, what a shame if you couldn't even go to church. I would just hate that if I couldn't even be in the congregation of the church. Let's look at verse 30. It says, the righteous shall never be removed, but the wicked shall not inhabit the earth. The righteous will never be removed from the earth, because when we rule and reign with Christ, we'll be there forever. But the wicked, they'll never even get to inhabit it. They'll always be in hell, my friend. And so you need to think about that. You're going to be on this earth forever. Why don't you get some works? Why don't you get some riches? Why don't you get rich towards God? Verse 31, the mouth of the just bringeth forth wisdom, but the froward tongue shall be cut out. But this whole chapter is about your mouth, my friend. Refraining your lips is wise. The mouth of the just bringeth forth wisdom. When you do get to open your mouth, the righteous will bring forth that wisdom. We should think about what we say so that the things that come out are always wisdom. Verse 32, the lips of the righteous know what is acceptable, but the mouth of the wicked speaketh forwardness. Look, if you're a righteous guy, if you want to be righteous, you need to know what's acceptable to come out of your mouth. And when you hear the words of the filthy, wicked people, you should be like, I want to never sound like that guy. Man. Turn to Proverbs chapter 15. That's the last place we'll turn. And I'll read for you a couple places. In Ephesians chapter 5, verse 12, the Bible says, for it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. Look, the things that these wicked reprobates do, the things that the abortion doctors do, it would be a shame to even speak of that filth. And we shouldn't be deceived to speak that kind of that perverseness. That would make us foolish. The righteous should have wisdom. And how you can have that grounded? What does the Bible say? Because the words of the Lord are pure words. That's how you can know where the boundaries are. That's where you can know where the lines are. But we shouldn't be speaking the shameful acts of the wicked people. We should make it known that they're doing these wicked things. And we can talk about it in a way that, you know, doesn't reveal all the wickedness, all the details of that sin. I don't want to know about it. I don't want to hear about it. I don't want to hear about their thoughts. I don't want to hear about their desires. I don't want to hear about what they did in secret. Don't ever speak it to me.
Right.
Never. But I want to know that they're doing this wicked stuff so we can get rid of it. I mean, we need to address the issue, but don't give me the details. It says in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 7, and a delivered just lot vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. Have you ever been around some ungodly people and just the perverted stuff coming out of the mouth? It just vexes your soul. It just hurts. Colossians chapter 3, verse 8, it says, but now ye also put off all these, anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. He's saying, look, not just blasphemy, but even just speaking filthy communication. We shouldn't be uttering those things that are perverse. And we look at Proverbs chapter 15, verse 26. The thoughts of the wicked are an abomination to the Lord. Isn't that right? I mean, even just the thoughts are so much of an abomination unto Him. It says, but the words of the pure are pleasant words. You know, this book is a pleasant book. This book is pure words. The Bible says that the words of the Lord are pure. And man doth not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. You want to have pleasantness in your life? Read this book to your children. Read this book to yourself. Read this book to your spouse. Fill yourself with the pleasant words. That way, when something comes out of your mouth, it's pleasant. It's not some wicked, filthy, disgusting thing. You're not just uttering all the perverseness of your mind. Tame your tongue with this book as best you can. Let's close in prayer. Thank you, Jesus Christ, for this chapter. I pray that we would just be wise and refrain our lips from those things which we shouldn't speak. That we'd fill ourselves with your words. That we'd fill ourselves with the Bible. And that we would be able to speak pleasant words. I pray that we would never hide our hatred towards those, but we'd let it known. But we would never slander against any of them. And that we would be known by our words. And that we'd realize that it's what we do in this life that matters. And that we should work and serve for you and not for men and not for this world. Thank you for all the souls win tonight. And thank you for this church. I pray that you just bless the soul winning marathon and all those that would come and help us win those to Christ. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.